What is up, guys? DJ Neeks here, and this is going to be my review of the movie Batman vs. Superman Dawn of Justice. So, I guess you could say this is probably the second video where I've done this. I kind of did one, kind of inadvertently, for Star Wars The Force Awakens, where at first it was just a video where I was going to talk about Star Wars The Old Republic versus Star Wars Battlefront, but then kind of became a review for the movie as well. So it got me thinking, considering that we have a year in 2016 where there are several movies coming out where that I'm really looking forward to, and we've already had a couple of movies, including Deadpool from earlier this year, and now with this one, that pretty much everyone's looking forward to and talking about, and there's more to come. Obviously, we have Civil War, we have X-Men, we have Warcraft, we have Assassin's Creed. So basically, yeah, I kind of thought, why don't I start for some of these certain movies? I mean, I don't go to the movies all that often anymore, but there are certain, and the reason why is because I used to work at a movie theater for 4.5 years, so at least I got a little tired of going to a movie theater, but there are certain movies like this one that I absolutely wanted to see when it came out. So, I didn't do a spoiler review for Star Wars. I kind of regret that now, though, because obviously there was some stuff in there. If you've seen the movie by now, you kind of know what I'm talking about that I kind of wanted to talk about. So, this one, though, I do want to talk about it because there's a lot to think about, take in, and say when it comes to this movie. And so while I talk about it, I figured what more fitting game to have in the background than Injustice Gods Among Us, where we can actually have some of these characters fighting each other, including Batman and Superman. In fact, you can even have the Man of Steel, Henry Cavill Superman skin here. Look at the good thing about the Ultimate Edition on PS4 is that you've got all the skins, you've got all the extra characters, all unlocked and everything. It's pretty cool. I mean, look at all these different skins for Superman. It's pretty awesome. So obviously, we'll start off with Superman versus Batman. Look at all these different Batman skins here. Let's go with the Arkham City Batman. So. Alright, now look, the point of this video is for me to talk about, give my thoughts on the movie, not for you guys to see how poor I am at fighting games. I'm not that good at fighting games, I never will claim to be good at fighting games, so I don't want to hear any of you criticizing how poor I am when it comes to the fighting games. That's why I'm going to be playing these matches on very easy. It's more so just to have something in the background while I'm discussing this movie. Alright, so let's get down to the nitty-gritty here. What are my thoughts on the movie? Well, I enjoyed it. I saw it last night, and I enjoyed it. It was pretty fun, you know, at least once you got to the second half. The first half, I mean, I'm okay with the first half. I was kind of thinking that the first half of this movie would be a little slow. That would be more so for setup. But that would be okay as long as the build was done well. If they did the build-up well, leading up to all the action in the second half, which is how I expected the movie to go, then, but if it was handled well, where by the time you got to the second half, you were like, all right, we've had all this build-up, and now I'm ready. I am ready for this to go down. Then it would be, I think it would be pretty cool. You know, it would be like we'd be all ready to go at that point. And, I mean, it depends how you look at it. I mean, if whether or not you could follow it, you know, all that well. I mean, yeah, it does spend a lot of the time talking, you know, it focuses a lot on what happened in Man of Steel. I mean, it's not, I don't know if it's official, but this pretty much is a sequel to Man of Steel because it deals directly with what happened at the end of Man of Steel with the, with Zod's forces trying to destroy Earth and turn it into another Krypton, with Superman stopping them, with Superman fighting Zod. The beginning of the movie actually shows that Ben Affleck, playing, of course, Bruce Wayne and Batman in this, that he was there in Metropolis when it went down. He was worried about all this happening, but more so he was worried about the people and that worked for him, his employees that were working in the Wayne Tower that is at in Metropolis. So because he was there and saw all this happen, we pretty much get an idea of what his motivation is for wanting to stop Superman when it gets down to that, about the motivation, why is he fighting Superman, things like that. And it does a good, I think a good job, at least early on, of showing why, but there are a couple times where it does falter a bit. But you get a pretty good idea as to why it's happening, in terms of, you know, Bruce Wayne's own motivation to stop Superman. Where, you know, it shows, you know, like the battle was going on. It shows the I-beams destroying the, the Wayne Tower. It shows some people getting hurt or even dying. And it's, yeah, you could see where he gets a bad first impression of Superman. And I'll let you know right off the bat, as a lot of people have been saying, is that Ben Affleck does a pretty darn good Batman. Definitely one of the better ones. He's definitely not in the category of Val Kilmer or George Clooney, as some people were fearing he would. In fact, some people are already saying that they actually, this is one of, if not their absolute favorite Batman, that they actually prefer this Batman even more so than Christian Bale's Batman. And it's, I could see where they're coming from, although this is a different Batman. This is a different Batman than what we're used to, because, and this is something that I was worried about when I found out that this movie was going to be inspired by Frank Miller's The Dark Knight Returns. Because I'll be honest with you guys, I'm not really a fan of The Dark Knight Returns, because I don't like this idea of this bitter old man, Bruce Wayne, throwing his moral code out the window, being now willing to kill criminals and such because, screw it, you know, that he's so fed up with it, he's like, forget about all that, I don't care about that anymore, to the point where I think the government and Superman tried to actually go after him and stop him, and it's like, it's something that I just never sat well with me, which is why I was never a fan of it. I know some people love it, but I've just never, it's never sat well with me. So, yeah, it's inspired by that. But, I mean, it doesn't take it directly. I mean, some people are even complaining that they should have just directly adapted Dark Knight Returns. I don't know if that would have helped it, but you could see where they got the inspiration for it. And there are hints throughout about that he's been doing this for a long time. Alfred at one point says, oh, 20 years of fighting criminals means nothing to you, huh? You know, when he's pretty much saying, like, oh, this would be, like, the one thing that I do, you know, when he's talking about why he wants to take down Superman, thinking that he's a threat to all humanity. And by the way, Jeremy Irons does a great Alfred. He's kind of the comedy relief somewhat, or he has the humor in the movie. Like, he'll say some things under his breath that are pretty funny, like, all right, you can go upstairs and maybe you'll find a lady that will, you know, that will keep you honest. And then he's like, in your dreams, Alfred, you know. So he's got some funny one-liners, but he's pretty much the only comedy in this movie. But there are hints as to things that have happened in this world, this DC world with Batman over the years. They show the suit, the Robin suit, which I believe is the Jason Todd Robin, with writing on it says, the joke's on you, Batman, indicating that that's the killing joke happened, that the Joker killed Jason Todd's Robin in this universe. So, and let's do the Arkham City Joker here. And why not? Let's have Joker versus Luthor, because here's something else I want to bring up. Whereas Ben Affleck's Batman was great, he does a great Batman, as I suspected, I hated Jesse Eisenberg's Lex Luthor. He's not Lex Luthor in this. Now, they make an excuse clarifying that, oh, it's not Lex Luthor, it's Lex Luthor's son, Alexander. You know, it's, get it, Alexander, Alex, Lex, get it, yeah. So they make that excuse saying that, yeah, that, you know, that he's not really that Lex Luthor, you know, which, why, to which I say, well, that's a shame because it would have made it better. See, here's the thing, and this is why I chose this battle here. He doesn't play Lex Luthor in this movie. It's like he's playing the Joker. You know, he's playing like he's a guy who should have a straitjacket and should be in an asylum. Which, who knows, maybe Arkham Asylum, that'd be kind of fitting. But I could not stand this portrayal of Lex Luthor in this. It was never the Lex Luthor that I thought it was supposed to be or should have been, because that's not the Lex Luthor I've grown up seeing. You know, obviously we know about, you know, like Gene Hackman's Lex Luthor from the Christopher Reeve Superman movies. We've seen, you know, despite how bad that, look, trust me, I'm not a fan of Superman Returns. That wasn't really a good Superman movie. But the casting choice of Kevin Spacey as Lex Luthor was a great casting choice. He fit the role perfectly. And you can also understand why many people said that they should have gotten Bryan Cranston as Lex Luthor, because, yeah, you can imagine his portrayal of Lex Luthor would have been spot on. At least, you know, based on what I think we've seen from him in the past. So, you know, especially if you've seen people thought that I've watched Breaking Bad, they were like, man, if he does Lex Luthor like he did the guy in Breaking Bad, he'd be a great Lex Luthor. But instead, they decided to go with Jesse Eisenberg instead, and, well, you'll see the result. It's not at all what you would expect. So, yeah, I did not like Jesse Eisenberg's Lex Luthor at all. But also, one of the other big casting decisions, Gal Gadot as Wonder Woman, many of us speculated whether or not she'd be a good choice, whether or not she fit, the physique that we're known from seeing from Wonder Woman, whether or not she could portray the character well, whether or not she could get the dialect right, because she has a very thick accent, and whether or not she could be able to disguise it enough. But usually actors are very good at doing that, of being able to change their voices, hide their accents and their dialects when it comes to doing characters and, you know, they're actors, and that's part of what they can do, well, what they do. So I wasn't necessarily worried about that, and it does show sometimes, like when she has to talk extensively, there were times where her accent came through, but I don't think it's really that big of a deal. I mean, I don't think it came across as an Israeli accent or anything, but in the long run, I don't think it's going to be that big of a deal, but we're obviously going to have to wait and see. I'll tell you this, she made me look forward to seeing her movie that's coming out next year, her own standalone movie. So I'm definitely looking forward to seeing that, seeing how she does within her own movie, how much more that she can do with the character, how much more she can show with the character, despite the lack of screen time in this. Because she does get some screen time, but not nearly as much, obviously, as Batman and Superman, which makes sense. So, now also, if you're wondering if there are different cameos and such, yes, there are. Cyborg is set up in this movie. The Flash is set up. Aquaman is set up. And I know that there are others that are going to be coming at some point. I do know that they are remaking Green Lantern, but that's like not going to come out till like 2020. And it's not going to be the Hal Jordan one, from what I've heard. It's going to be the Jon Stewart Green Lantern. I mean, that's much farther down the road. We do have, obviously, each of them are also set to get their own movies. Cyborg set to get his own movie. The Flash. Aquaman, which is why they set them all up. I don't know if Ben Affleck's Batman is going to get his own standalone movie, although he should, because he was really one of the strengths of the movie, and really having him be in his own Batman movie, standalone movie, would be pretty cool. When it comes to the movie, once you get past the first half and all the political, philosophical stuff that they do in this movie, when it comes to Superman and his power and his being a threat to humanity and all that stuff, once you get past that and it gets to the second half with the action, it really gets good, because the action in this is pretty awesome. And some of the stuff they do set up for the big fight between them that we all knew was coming. In the trailer, some of the shots didn't necessarily make that much sense, but they do have it make sense when you actually see it in the movie. And so, if I haven't given it out yet, the spoiler warning. So, yes, this is going to be, I'm going to talk some spoilers here, so you have been warned. You may want to either pause the video, stop it, close it, whatever, if you don't want to get spoiled about certain things, because I'm going to start talking about some other spoilers here that may or may not have been in the trailers. All right. Are they gone? All right. So, for those of you that have stuck around and don't care about the spoilers, or you've seen the movie and you already know, yeah, they, right off the bat, after we see the opening scene with Metropolis getting destroyed at the end of Man of Steel, we then cut to 18 months later, and we see, it says, somewhere in the Indian Ocean, and some group of people, or divers, end up finding a very familiar-looking green rock. And yes, as you would expect, it is kryptonite. Right off the bat, in only the second appearance in movie of Henry Cavill Superman, we have kryptonite involved. And I was a little surprised they went to it this early, but I guess it makes sense because that ends up being the big factor in whether or not Batman could actually be able to defeat Superman. And it does play a big factor. Because by the time you get to the fight, first off, he finds out that Luthor has been using a group to smuggle it to him. Batman thinks it has to do with some kind of criminal organization. He finds out they're working for Luthor. He finds out what it is. And because at this point he's already kind of determining to stop Superman, because he sees him as a possible threat, because he's already seen how many people have died in Metropolis in that fight, how many people actually do die in this, not as an indirect result, not Superman's fault, but of course, the way Luthor manipulates everything frames him and makes everyone think that it is his fault. So he's also manipulating Bruce Wayne and, you know, in the process of making him think that Superman is responsible. So Batman wants to get the kryptonite for himself to use it when he fights Superman, because Superman is also, as Clark Kent, he's finding out about this bat vigilante who's going around being pretty brutal, intimidating criminals. They show a scene where a criminal was found, or like what looked like he was tortured, and he branded the bat signal on his skin. So he's like, oh, this bat vigilante is terrorizing people. And, you know, the scene at the party where they talk to each other about it, trying to get a feel for this bat vigilante, talking to Bruce Wayne, who at the time did not know that he was Batman, that Bruce Wayne was Batman, although I think it's later, it's clear he does find out. I think Lex tells him at the pivotal moment where Lex pretty much sets up this fight in motion. So the reason the fight happens is not because they want to fight each other. It's because Lex pretty much forces it. And, you know, it's all been his manipulation the whole time. The whole political thing kind of goes nowhere because it's all about framing Superman, because he gets Superman to go there. And in the whole process of setting it up by Luthor, as soon as he gets there, he has this guy who lost his legs because of what happened in Metropolis and has been a Superman hater. The guy's going to be there to pretty much try and say that this is what Superman did to me. He's a false god. He's not a hero and all that. And Lex was trying to get him on it, you know, have him be on his side. Or rather, he was like, oh, it's all right. I'm on your side. You know, I want to get behind your cause of trying to take Superman down and all that. And also trying to get the senator, who was played by Holly Hunter, to work with him, but she didn't want to do it. Basically, he gives the guy a wheelchair. It's like, oh, this is how much I'm sympathizing with you. I'm giving you this special wheelchair. We then find out the real chair had a bomb in it. And as soon as Superman is there at the Capitol Hill, boom, the bomb goes off. Everyone there dies except Superman, of course, because a bomb can't kill him. And of course, now people are going, oh, Superman had something to do with it. You know, part of Luthor's plan to try and have everyone turn against Superman. And I do want to touch on that, his plan. I couldn't really figure out what his motivations were, because when he explained it, he is talking like a crazy man that it was hard to really understand what he was saying or what his motivations were to bring Superman down. He was never really clear on it. It was because he was just like talking like a crazy person, you know, like about him being, he sees him as a devil or something, you know, and it was very unclear about why he was doing what he was doing, you know, his motivations and all that. I couldn't really put my finger on it because it was hard to understand what he was saying. It does make you feel like you have to see the movie a second time just to hear what they're saying, because unfortunately some of the pacing and at some parts in this movie is so fast, it's hard to process what you just saw, because then it cuts to the next scene, which has something else you got to pay attention to, while you're going, wait a minute, can I have a moment to process what I just saw to figure out what happened in that scene I just saw? So the criticisms I've heard about the pacing and the editing, that it's like a bit of a mess, that I can understand, because there were some times where I did understand where they were coming from in that regard, because it did feel that way at times. In a couple of those scenes, there's a scene where Batman has a nightmare about, for those of us who have played this game that I'm playing, Injustice Gods Among Us, you know about this alternate parallel universe scenario where Joker got Superman to inadvertently blow up Metropolis. He killed Lois and their unborn child. So Superman pretty much becomes a dictator of the entire world, goes bad. And they kind of depict that in this nightmare scenario where the entire world is kind of run by Superman, in which he has like his own army, which they were kind of, you know, with the logo and how they were armored up. It was, as soon as Superman showed up, they bowed to him. I mean, I almost expected them to like do a Heil kind of salute, as if they were playing like he's like running this now army that worships Superman, as if he's like, as if they were the Nazis and stuff. I wasn't sure if they would go that way or if they should, but you know, they were basically playing up the whole idea that he is like a totalitarian dictator of the entire world now, which is why in that nightmare Batman's trying to get the kryptonite to try and stop Superman, but he gets captured by his army, and as soon as he arrives, they all kneel before him like he is their master, their lord, their god. Now, another aspect about that nightmare, which is part of the setup that there's quite a bit of setup in this for the movies they have in mind, is that in the nightmare on the ground in front of this destroyed city, you see a logo on the ground. And for those of us who are knowledgeable DC fans, we know that the logo on the ground was a logo that is synonymous with with Darkseid, who is like the Thanos of the DC universe. He's the ruler of the planet Apocalypse. He's a being who's supposed to be as strong and powerful as Superman, and he's like the complete opposite. He is completely evil. He wants to rule the entire universe, and he's powerful enough to do so. He has an entire evil, dark army that works for him, who they kind of showed in this. Like, they were, like, flying, like, locust soldiers. So it hinted at Darkseid, and then it shows that Superman is, like, ruling the world. So this, to me, reminded me of an episode, I think it was Justice League Unlimited, where Darkseid was somehow able to either brainwash Superman or get him to have amnesia, where he pretty much thinks he's supposed to be the ruler of the planet Earth, that he's like Darkseid's son, and he pretty much takes the army there to try and take over the world before, you know, and then obviously later on he gets his memory back and realizes who he is, that he's Superman. But the damage has already been done, where some people are already saying that Superman no longer defends us. He's You know, so the damage was done at that point. But that's what that reminded me of, where it was playing up that Darkseid was Superman's commander or whatever, and that Superman was, like, running things on Earth for Darkseid. At least that's what I think they were trying to imply, unless they are actually setting up an Injustice movie, which, considering that the story in this game was pretty good, a movie on that would be probably pretty good. But obviously that's farther down the road. And I think that may be a little too early for that. But that was an interesting thing. But here's my problem, and this is why I brought up the aspect about the pacing and the editing. As soon as that nightmare is over and you think he's woken up from it, all of a sudden you see some figure in red, like, come through what looks like a time portal or something, and he's yelling at him, like, well, Lois Lane is the key! You were right about him! You know, and I couldn't tell who it was at first. I think some people have said that it was the Flash, which, in some ways, that would make sense because of his ability to run back through time and use the Time Force. He was kind of in a red outfit, but he had, like, a helmet on that had a mask that vroom, vroom, went up and down, almost like Dark Helmet from Spaceballs. But I mean, it didn't seem like the Flash, but maybe that was the Flash. I honestly don't know. Some people are saying it was, but it's one of those where I gotta watch it again, and I gotta really look for things to, like, did he have the Flash logo on him? Like, I mean, so in some ways it makes sense, but it's something I gotta confirm to be sure. And then he wakes up from that. So he apparently had a nightmare inside of a nightmare, and then we just continue with the movie. And it's like, wait a minute. That's kind of an important moment, don't you think? Shouldn't you let us kind of just settle from that and just kind of process it? Nope, the movie continues from there. Just like, okay, just continue as normal. It's way too fast for its own good. And it never lets us be able to process certain things that happen. It just wants to keep going because it feels like they were trying to shove so much into this. And then when they got to the editing floor, they were cutting stuff because they must have shot so much of this movie. I've heard that the director's cut is going to have an extra half hour, which is going to make this like a 3-hour long movie. And it's going to be an R-rated version because apparently they had to cut half an hour of footage to bring it down to PG-13, where it actually involved an actress who was apparently playing Barbara Gordon in this movie, but they cut her out of the movie, and I'm not really sure why. We'll have to wait and see until it comes out on Blu-ray in order to find out why they cut it and why it was rated R and why they said she was a key character. But it's funny, if she's a key character, why would you cut her out of the movie? You know, some people said, well, this is probably a ploy on their part to drive up Blu-ray sales, and you know, it wouldn't surprise me if that was the case. But it just feels like they were trying to shove so much. It feels like there's multiple movies here crammed into one, that some of the stuff in this should have been in separate standalone movies, but they're trying so desperately to catch up to Marvel, to set up all these other things, to set up the Justice League movies, you know, trying to make Justice League seem just as good as Marvel without having the pacing and storytelling that Marvel took, where it all started with the first Iron Man movie, and then when that was such a huge success, they realized they could continue this, and they kept doing it with other characters until the Avengers came along, and by the time Avengers came along, it was a huge hit because it was so highly anticipated, because we had gotten to know all these characters, with the exception of Black Widow and Hawkeye, but we had gotten to know some of these other characters in the anticipation that Avengers was coming. Like, they kept hinting at it in the other movies. They hinted at it in Iron Man 2. They hinted at it in The Incredible Hulk. They hinted at it in the first Captain America movie. And so then by the time it came along, it was like, wow. I mean, this is only the second movie in this cinematic universe. Man of Steel was the first one, and now we've had this one. And they're already, you know, the other aspects about this movie in the spoiler area. So let's get back to where it continues from the action. So obviously we had the big battle. First off, they don't explain the suit that Batman wears in this battle. They don't explain why that suit is a certain, you know, is the way it is. That it's got all that, it's a big metal suit. what it's made out of that helps give him the edge. Although there is a really cool scene where they are showing Bruce Wayne is training. It was like an 80s montage scene. It was pretty awesome. He was pulling a giant tire. He was doing chin-ups or, you know, he was with weights strapped or chained to his legs. He was doing all these ridiculous weights and exercises and, you know, pretty much trying to bulk himself up. Ben Affleck was jacked in this movie. He got jacked for this character, for this role, because he had the muscles. He clearly got himself in shape to do this. And it was a pretty cool scene. I'm surprised they didn't have like a song in the background of like an 80s montage. You know, like, you're the best around, no one's ever gonna keep you down. You know, that would have been pretty hilarious. It would have been pretty cool. But, yeah. I was hoping they would explain the metal suit for the fight. They did not. He just shows up, he flips the light, he's got the suit on, and that's it. No explanation, no seeing him working on the suit. He really doesn't work on the suit at all. It's pretty much Alfred who works on the tech and everything. They show him testing out the voice modulator that he uses when he's Batman, which I thought was kind of cool. Whereas Christian Bale just, he went for, you know, with his voice on his own, you know, just trying to give himself, you know, like a sore throat on his own, that instead he uses a voice modulator to change his voice, which adds to the mythos that he needs to change how his voice sounds when he's Batman so that he doesn't make people think that he's Bruce Wayne. So I thought that was kind of cool. So when the fight happens, the reason it happens in the first place, I mean, he flips on the signal waiting for Superman because Superman confronts him and he says, next time that your light goes on in the sky, don't answer it. The bat is dead, buried, which to me didn't really come across as, you know, something that Superman would usually say, but they're playing up that Superman sees Batman as a cold-blooded vigilante who's just being brutal with criminals unnecessarily, that he's the real criminal here and not Superman, you know, that he's the innocent one, that Batman's the real villain here. Batman at that point is planning to fight him, so he's like, it's like, tell me, do you bleed? And he flies away and goes, you will. Which is clever foreshadowing for what happens in the fight. So Lex gets Lois Lane to him. He pushes Lois Lane off to get Superman to where he is. He tells Superman, so guess what? You're going to go fight the Batman, because if you don't, your mother, Martha Kent, is going to die. Because I've captured her and she's a hostage now. So that's why Superman goes out there. And now first he's like, listen, Batman, you got to help me save my mom. And Batman doesn't really want to listen to him, because at that point he's determined to fight him. And he just is like, yeah, shut up. And so he like uses weapons. He has like machine guns ready to fire at him. And then he uses what clearly gives him the factor he needed to give him a chance to win this fight, which... he steals the kryptonite from Lex Luthor's lab, and he then works on it to create some weapons that he can use against Superman in the fight. He creates some smoke grenades that utilizes the kryptonite. He creates a spear of pure kryptonite on it, and when this grenade goes off, it weakens him. Now, the shot we saw in the trailer where he was able to block Superman's punch, we are all like, how could he do that? How can he block Superman's punch? And at first, it makes you think, well, maybe it's the suit. Maybe the suit's just that strong. It's not about the suit. It's the reason that Superman was shocked that he was able to block his punch is all about that he uses the kryptonite smoke grenade. And because he used the kryptonite smoke grenade, it was able to weaken Superman enough where Batman was able to block his punch. So I thought that was cool, that it was like, okay, so that's why that shot was... thrown there. That's why that was a cool shot, to help set up the whole aspect of the kryptonite being able to weaken Superman. So that is what made it kind of an even fair fight. It was only temporary, because then you could see that Superman was starting to regain his strength. He then used another grenade to re-weaken him. And it comes to the point where Batman's about to actually win the fight. He's about to actually kill Superman. And that's something about this Batman, is, you know, it's like the Dark Knight Returns Batman, where he's not he doesn't really have a moral code when it comes to, he doesn't restrain from killing bad guys or whatever. He does kill some people, some criminals, maybe even some innocents. I gotta rewatch it to, like, keep track of how many people actually died, you know, as a result of what Batman was doing. But he's, like, ready to drive the spear of Kryptonite into Superman to end him. And Superman, at the, you know, at the last moment says, you gotta save Martha. And this was something I don't think I ever realized, was that Batman's mom and Superman's mom had the same first name, Martha. And I thought, that's a funny coincidence. I can't believe I never actually put that together before. That was a cool little thing, because then it stops him. It makes him stop, because he's starting to have flashbacks of his own mom. And he's like, why'd you say that name? And Lois shows up and she tells him, because it's his mom's name. And it makes Batman... Now, the reason that then he flips, that they pretty much become buds and they decide to team up to take down Luthor, is because this makes Batman realize, because he's taunting him the whole time, saying that he's not a man, he's only, he's an alien, he's not a real, not an actual man or anything like that. I'm going to show you what a real man is. A man has courage. You know, he has one-liners and taunts him during the fight. But then after this, he realizes, he has a mom. He's just a normal guy, as normal as Superman can get, really. But this kind of humanizes Superman in Batman's eyes. So, and at that point, Luthor's other main plan, which they've been showing at that point, where he's working, he actually gets the government to give him Zod's body. He gets access to the crashed Kryptonian ship, which I actually forgot that was actually still there. That the ship was actually still there. I thought it had been destroyed, that all the ships had been destroyed, but I guess not. It was still there, and Luthor takes Zod's body there, and somehow uses the Kryptonian technology to merge Zod's dead body with Luthor's own blood to somehow then reanimate him, and this leads to him becoming Doomsday. So based on that fight you just saw me do between Doomsday and Zod, the reason I did that is because, yeah, in this version, Doomsday is essentially Zod brought back to life, but mutated. So, yeah, Doomsday. He didn't look that great. Many of us thought when we first saw him in the trailer that he looked like the cave troll from the Fellowship of the Ring, which, he pretty much straight up does. I was kind of thrown off by that they stuck with that. But, that was pretty much what they decided to go for in terms of his design. He did not look that great. But it was also because, in the comic version of Doomsday, he was a monster that came from space that was just as powerful as Superman, and that's why he was able to kill him. And that's what Doomsday became known for. So the fact that he was Zod, or what remained of Zod, just mutated to become Doomsday to defeat Superman, just kind of threw me off. And it was something I'm not really sure I was in favor of, but I guess it could explain why he had the powers, that he did, that it was what Zod's powers were. So I guess in that regard, it could make sense. So yeah, Batman goes off to save Martha Kent, and Superman goes to confront Luthor, which then Luthor activates him. And the reason it's Doomsday is because he cleverly says, when he's turning having the monster become alive, he's like, this is your, I forget what he said, but he ends it with, your Doomsday. And then the monster comes out of his cocoon and it's like, I'm going to destroy you. But he doesn't actually say that, but he's roaring like he's intent on killing Superman. To which then, we get a couple of things where, at one point Superman tries to take him to space. The military decides, let's nuke them because, well, screw it. Screw whether or not Superman may die. Screw the consequences of nuking, blowing up a nuke in orbit or in the atmosphere. Forget about that. Let's just go ahead and do that. To which, of course, as we expected, it does nothing to either to Doomsday. It does. They do actually show that it kind of decays Superman, or like it shows him like as if he's like a withered body who's like lost his life as if he's like skin and bones or something, which threw me off because I don't remember a nuke being able to do that to Superman. But the point of the scene was to show that then as he rotated around the Earth, he came into the, you know, where the sun could shine on him, and it showed him regenerating from the sun. His eyes light up like, I'm super powered now, I've gone Super Saiyan Superman, which is kind of ironic considering the whole death battle thing that they've been doing on the internet. But anyway, just as Doomsday is trying to kill Batman, Wonder Woman shows up. She finally actually shows up as Wonder Woman. We've seen her as Diana Prince a few times in the movie, but she finally shows up as Wonder Woman, and they actually did some things with her I wasn't necessarily expecting, but I was pleasantly surprised by. They got her shield down, they got her her braces, you know, to deflect. It actually deflects the blast of Doomsday, which was like, wow. And she even, like, you know, does a move where she clashes them and it causes an explosion, like an attack. I wasn't expecting that. They showed that her sword and shield are pretty strong. It actually cuts off Doomsday's hand, which it then regenerates, because they showed that he could actually, you know, evolve or whatever. And, but another thing that pleasantly surprised me was that she actually had, a lasso. They actually showed her lasso in this, where she used it on Doomsday, and I was not expecting that they were going to use the lasso, but they did, and it actually looked really good. So, like I said earlier, it was this fight that made me, like, really look forward to seeing her own standalone movie, I think coming out next year. So yeah, it reaches the point where the three of them now are going to team up to destroy Doomsday, but they pretty much realize that the only thing that can stop Doomsday is that kryptonite spear that Batman made to kill Superman. At one point, Lois throws it into a water, like, to get rid of it so that it can't ever be used to kill Superman. And now she realizes, oh, crap, maybe I shouldn't have done that. I need to go back and get that, you know, deep underwater. So she goes over, rocks fall on top of where she is. So she has to, you know, she's drowning, she's dying. And, of course, Superman has to go save her, which, because he's so close to the spear, it weakens him, which then leads to, and this is a big spoiler for all you guys, so be ready, okay? And the reason I'm taking a breath is because I'm conflicted about this. So, Superman takes the kryptonite spear. Well, before that, he tells Lois, I love you, you are my world, which, at that point, you're realizing Superman's going to die, isn't he? Because usually he wouldn't say that unless he thinks or knows he's going to die. So, yeah, he drives the spear into Doomsday. Doomsday uses the evolved hand, which is like his own spear, to stab Superman. And the reason he could do that is because the spear weakened him to where he could actually be able to do that. And so Superman, quote-unquote, has died. Then again, those of us who are knowledgeable Superman fans know he can't actually die because, one, we've seen this in that famous comic book, and also there was an animated movie called Superman Doomsday. I recommend checking that out, where they show this in an entire movie where Superman fights Doomsday, he gets killed, and at one point, I think a different villain tries to, you know, destroy or whatever, or maybe Doomsday comes back. I forget. I gotta see that movie again. But because Superman at that point was gone, he was actually just kind of regenerating or hibernating until he could come back, and they show, hey, he came back. So he actually wasn't dead. He was just kind of regaining his strength, you know? So, yeah. So in that moment when he dies, I wasn't sad at all, really, because I'm like, he can't die. If you're trying to make me feel sad, you're only playing off of unknowledgeable Superman fans who don't know that tidbit about Superman's mythos and lore. But I know that lore, so yeah. But they play it up real sad. They show Batman and Wonder Woman grieving for him, but they also, because of the cameos involving those other heroes that they're hinting that they want to go get, they are pretty much discussing that they're going to find them and try and gather them together and that they're going to fight. And I think one of my opponents was like, what do you mean fight? Fight what? And he's like, it's just a feeling. Based, you know, things like, I think something's going to happen. Which I think is, you know, emphasizing that because Batman saw what happened in that nightmare, he's anticipating what is going to happen involving the likes of Darkseid and such. So that's pretty much what I think he was referring to. That he's like, look, I know a threat's coming, so we have to be ready. We have to get those guys so we can be ready to do so. Because now that Superman's not here, well, we have to do more. So in that regard, yeah, I could see what they were doing for the setup. And then the movie ends with, you think, you know, I was fully anticipating, of course, and I think pretty much everyone knew that when the last shot was like of his casket, those of us who know about Superman's lore, we were like, yeah, he's not dead. And sure enough, the last shot is, like, Lois had just, you know, done the, you know how at a funeral, when a loved one, you know, drops some dirt on the casket before they start burying the casket? That's what she had just done, so some of the dirt was on his casket. And by the way, they did two funerals. They did one for Clark Kent and one for Superman. And then the last shot is you see the dirt start to lift up into the air, and then it cuts the credits, basically showing that, yeah, Superman's coming back to life or is on the verge of. But from what I understand, it takes a little longer than that. So, yeah, so Superman, quote-unquote, dies at the end, even though I know he's actually not dead. He's just rejuvenating, but whatever. So, yeah, the movie has its issues. It is a mixed bag for me, and I'm going to have to see it again because there was so much to take and process in this movie that it was hard to take it all in the first time around because of the pacing, because it wouldn't let you settle in. It wouldn't let you breathe to process some of the other stuff that they were showing in this movie. So you got to see it again to, like, really pay attention now that you know what's going to happen. You got to see it again just to really pay attention to what they were saying, you know, what they were setting up and all that. So in that regard, I'm going to have to see it again at some point just so I can really be able to evaluate or, like, really take in what they were doing in some of those scenes. But it didn't really hurt my enjoyment all that much. As a big diehard fan of both Batman and Superman, I thoroughly enjoyed watching this movie. It's not a terrible movie. It's not a piece of trash. It's not any of that stuff that the internet and other reviewers have been saying, these movie critics with their negative reviews. I think they are being very unnecessarily harsh on the movie, and they're probably judging it more so, we have to judge it by our own standards of how we judge a movie, you know, as a movie should be judged, rather than how did you enjoy the movie? Are you a fan of the characters? And did you enjoy watching it? And based on that, despite the issues, I would give it my thumbs up. You know, I would give it like an 8 out of 10. Now, if that's a little high for you, then, you know, obviously, you know, those issues probably hurt your enjoyment of the movie more so than it did mine. But I still enjoyed this movie. So, yeah, I say definitely go see it. And I'm planning on seeing it at some point, I don't know when, but at some point I would definitely want to see it again, just so I can try and process some of those things that I may have missed the first time around. But yeah, I definitely want to see this again, to be able to fully evaluate it, to process some of the things that they threw in this movie. But again, it felt like they were trying to cram numerous things and cram numerous movies into one movie. Like, it felt like 3, 4, or 5 movies crammed into one. Like, the Superman dying, that should have been in a standalone Superman movie where Doomsday shows up and it's, you know, but I mean, it feels like it's way too early to be doing this, to be using Doomsday. It's too early to be killing off Superman, because if they do anything more, like with like any threats like Brainiac or anything like that, there's no stakes now, because they've already done the Superman dies but he comes back aspect, so that's done now, so you can't use it again, and there's no reason to feel like, oh no, what if, because they've already killed him with the likes of Doomsday here. It just feels like there were opportunities and potential to do some really good stuff, and they messed it up. They did it way too fast, too early. Instead of taking their time doing similar storytelling to how Marvel has been doing. The reason Civil War, that we all have the benefit of the doubt that Civil War is going to be amazing, is because they've earned that. They've earned that benefit of the doubt. Warner Brothers has not. They're trying to be Marvel, even though sometimes they say, we're not trying to be Marvel. Yes, they are. They are trying to be Marvel. But they're trying too hard. They're trying to do it too fast. So I really enjoyed the movie despite the issues that it's had. You know, yes, I do have my issues. It is a mixed bag that I had my issues with. But I still enjoyed it. I still had a fun time watching the movie. For a movie like this, I'm pretty sure you have to see it at least twice, because they throw so much at you and it's such a fast pace that you hardly have time to really process it. So I definitely recommend going to see it if you are a fan of superhero movies. The comic book movies are going on this year. If you're a fan of Superman, Batman, you may end up loving this Batman more than Christian Bale's Batman. You know, I can definitely see that, because I know a lot of people already really love this Batman. Ben Affleck does a great job. I didn't like Lex Luthor in this. I did like Wonder Woman. They hint at some other aspects that have happened in this cinematic universe, like the Killing Joke with Joker killing Robin. Obviously, they have set up with the Justice League movies and the other, as well as the standalone movies for these other characters, like Aquaman and The Flash and Cyborg. So they do that. So it did make me look forward to those movies. I'm definitely now looking forward to the Aquaman movie, the Cyborg movie. I don't know about the Flash movie, because I'm so used to seeing Grant Gustin's Flash and the Flash show that I'm just not really sure if I'm all that eager to see a new guy to play Flash in his own movie, because I would be more excited if they had the same guy, Grant Gustin, because that's who I'm used to seeing as Flash. But who knows? Maybe it's going to pleasantly surprise me at how they decide to do so. I just, it's similar to how I've been feeling about this movie. My 3 years of anticipation and hype about how amazing this movie could be, it's not as amazing as I thought it would be. But it's still good. It's still a good movie. I still thoroughly enjoyed it, despite its issues. It is still a mixed bag for me. It's good. I enjoyed it, but it still has its issues. But I still really enjoyed it, and I'm definitely wanting to see it again at some point. Partly to process it, but also because I also want to see the stuff I enjoyed again, like the big fights, the big fight with Batman and Superman. I definitely want to see that again. I thought that was really cool, even though it was a little short, but it could have been longer. But it was still, I thought, really well done. So yeah, that's my review of Batman vs. Superman, Dawn of Justice. It had its hiccups, its setbacks, but it's still, I thought, pretty good. I'll tell you what, I'm definitely looking forward to seeing the director's cut at some point to see this extra half hour or so of footage to see what was it they cut out that maybe could help in certain aspects or certain parts of the movie in terms of scenes that may have helped the story and such. But we're going to have to wait for that. So I give it my approval to go see it. Handle or manage your expectations. If you're going into this expecting DC's version of the Avengers or such, you're going to be disappointed. But if you're a fan of Batman or Superman, I think you're going to enjoy this. So yeah, that's my review of Batman vs. Superman. And I will see you guys next time.